brought to you by the partners and friends of Creflo Dollar Ministries.
Coming up next on Changing Your World.
Grace teaches me. Over these past 14 days, I have learned so much because grace has been teaching me. I'm excited about teaching you today because I don't have stuff I just got out of the Scripture. And I got some experience to mix with the Scripture. Oh, Rabbi Shatta. Grace teaches me. You remember I told you, if you really want to know if the Bible is true, you got to go in the kitchen and cook.
No matter where you are on your personal journey, the Word of God can reach you. At work or simply needing to hear from the Lord, tune in to World Changers every Sunday at 10 a.m. or restream at 2 p.m., 6 p.m., and 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Text WATCH NOW to 51555 or visit worldchangers.org for more information about services and stream times. We're in this together. No matter where we are World Changers. See you online.
This is your world, so let's vow to make it a better place. Let every heart that needs to know your love is here to stay. Oh, it's time we live a new life. Oh, let us love shine bright in you. We're saved by His grace, so we embrace your love today. We are changed.
Last time we were together, I talked to you about how the grace of God teaches us to refuse ungodliness. And we showed you that to live a life of ungodliness is to live a life neglecting God. It is to live a life where you're not regarding God. And we showed you that that can happen in the life of a Christian as well as somebody that's not born again. That as a Christian, if you live a life and you do things and don't even feel like it's necessary to even get God to bless it, that's ungodliness. Or if you live a life and you don't take God into account in the things that you do in your life, that's ungodliness. And so we realize that we have to have God a part of everything that we do in our lives. So today we're going to continue that. We're going to talk about how grace teaches us not only to deny ungodliness, but how grace teaches us to deny, and this is a big subject in the church, how to deny worldly lust. The first thing we got to do is figure out what that is. And then we're going to have to see how we've been misjudging the situation and in some cases, misjudging other people. Because a lot of times as Christians, we got to be careful not to take the cheaper for the deeper or take the cheaper instead of the deeper. And I'll show you what that means today. So let's get into Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. Let's read verse 11 through 13 and then go back and milk it a little bit. And this is going to be an amazing series. And again, I am trusting that your ears are anointed to hear. Amen. He says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, that we should live soberly, we should live righteously, and we should live godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior, Jesus Christ." I thought that was interesting that in the middle of this, he says the grace of God is going to teach us to deny these things, and the grace of God is going to teach us how to live a godly way. But in the midst of it, he says, and as you are doing this, get your focus on the return. Get your focus on the appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, what does that have to do with anything? All right, let's back up and look at verse 11. Milk this and get into this today. "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men." So this grace of God, remember, first of all, that Jesus, full of grace and truth, okay? So when we talk about the grace of God, we are ultimately talking about a person. And his name is Jesus. Jesus, full of grace and full of truth. Now, we have defined grace as this unmerited, abounding provision of the unrestricted operation of God's infinite love that comes through Jesus Christ for mankind, and especially for those who will depend upon him. And so we're talking about the grace of God. We're talking about this unmerited, abounding provision, that grace, in the unrestricted operation of his love. And so this unrestricted operation of God's love has been made available to the whole world. Everybody on the planet has an opportunity to receive this unrestricted operation of God's love and to depend on him. Everybody does. So here's the deal. Only those who believe and receive Jesus as their Lord and personal Savior are those who have received this grace. There are people, it's made available to everybody, but not everybody has received it. Not everybody believes it. Not everybody wants it. But for those of us who believe it and those of us who receive it, how many of you believe in Jesus Christ? Amen. How many of you have received his unrestricted operation of love? Amen. I received that. I received that. God loves me. Amen. I can't tell you how vital that is in the life of a Christian for you to come to a point in your life where you recognize, I know God loves me, and that your faith rests in the love of God, and your faith for healing rests in the love of God. In other words, because God loves you, you know you're healed. Because God loves you, you know you're delivered. Because God loves you, you know that awesome things happen in your life. You know, the last 14 days, shingles attacked my body. And every time I went to preach somewhere, I said, his grace is sufficient for me. That didn't mean it was painful. It was the nastiest pain I've ever experienced before in my life. But his grace. Yes. I had to know that. Yes. It's sufficient for me, praise the Lord. And I'm in expecting it. The deeper and deeper I grow in the knowledge and revelation of God, the Apostle Paul said, there was a thorn in his flesh sent by Satan, and he went to God three times about it, and God kept saying, grace is sufficient, grace is sufficient. And Paul recognized, oh, I get it. When I'm weak, he's made strong. We got to stop trying to be strong when we're strong, and we're going to learn how to be strong when we're weak. Amen? And I want to not just know this, I want to know it. I want to walk in it. I want to demonstrate it. I can't tell you how excruciating it was. On the past Thursday night, I'm getting on an airplane, going to travel to preach the gospel. But his grace is sufficient for me. And I know he loves me. Are you understanding what I'm saying? I know God loves me. And so not everybody receives that. Not everybody believes that. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. Every person on the planet has the same opportunity as you and I had to receive and believe this grace of God. If you understand that, say amen. Amen. All right, now watch what this grace of God does to those of us who believe it. Next verse, verse 12. It teaches us. Now, this is interesting. The grace of God teaches us who believe. It doesn't teach everybody. See, grace has been made available to everybody, but he can't teach everybody unless they believe it and receive it. So grace teaches us. Say this out loud. Grace teaches me. Grace teaches. So you have a teacher. The grace of God is teaching you. Glory be to God. The grace of God is teaching you. You got to believe that grace is able to instruct you and to teach you. Now, that's awesome to me because people say you got to be careful about that grace now, because that grace can cause you to live a loose life, and that grace will cause you to be sinful. If it's anything responsible for teaching you good Christian conduct, it's the grace of God. The grace of God is not teaching you how to sin and compromise. The grace of God is teaching you how to live a godly life. He will teach us. And so that means I don't have to put so much pressure on me trying to get it, more than me putting pressure on me, not even putting pressure there, but me believing and me receiving Jesus as my Lord and Savior and receiving grace teaching me. Grace teaches me. Grace teaches me. Over these past 14 days, I have learned so much because grace has been teaching me. I'm excited about teaching you today because I don't have stuff I just got out of the Scripture. And I got some experience to mix with the Scripture. Oh, Rabashata. Grace teaches me. You remember I told you, if you really want to know if the Bible is true, you got to go in the kitchen and cook. You know, if you got two recipes and both of them say it's chocolate cake, you need to go in there and find out which recipe is authentic. Honey, join me in my kitchen as we cook up Scriptures to find out which is authentic. How and what have you been cooking in your kitchen so that you'll stop questioning the Bible, but know that you know because you've been cooking it in your kitchen? Well, how do you know that's true? Because I cook it in my kitchen, amen? It teaches us, now watch what it teaches us. It teaches us to deny. Now, the word deny means to refuse it. It teaches us to deny ungodliness, or it teaches us to refuse to disregard and neglect God. Grace will teach you how to refuse disregarding and neglecting and leaving God out your life. Grace will teach you that. Some stuff you're not going to know until you know. Some stuff you're not going to get because I taught it through the pulpit. Some of the stuff you got to catch when you're going through stuff in life. I'm trying to teach you, but you won't get it until stuff happens. And I pray that's not always the truth, that I pray that you can get some stuff from the pulpit so it's not necessary for you to go through certain things. But I know certain things I had to go through in order to learn and understand, oh, that's what that means. Grace will teach you to deny ungodliness. I don't want to do nothing without God. I don't want to hardly get dressed without God. I don't want to disregard Him. I don't want to neglect Him. Honey, if you ever been married before and it was a bad marriage, ain't no way in the world you trying to get engaged without finding out what Jesus think about this thing first, amen? Grace will teach you, amen? It'll teach you to deny ungodliness, and it'll teach you to deny and refuse, watch this, worldly lust. Now, this needs to be talked about, worldly lust. And notice what grace will teach you. Grace will teach you how to live soberly. Grace will teach you how to live righteously. Grace will teach you how to live godly or regarding God in everything. He'll do that in this present world. And while grace is teaching you, look at verse 13, you need to be looking for the blessed hope. While grace is teaching you, you need to be looking for that glorious appearance of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So we got to move from looking at what's in front of us, and we got to start looking at what's ahead of us, amen. Grace is teaching you while you're looking for this. I'm still looking for the return of the Lord. Every now and then I hear a trumpet on somebody's phone or watch, and I look up real quick. I'm thinking Jesus coming back. You know, Brother Oscar had a little horn on his telephone that went out, doo, 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 and I'm thinking, wait a minute, that's a weak trumpet, but I still looked up, you know. I'm looking for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm looking for it. I'm expecting to see Jesus one day. I want to make sure that I don't stand in front of Him in regret, knowing I could have did it better. I could have, you know, I'm excited about seeing Him, not too soon when the time comes. I'm excited about seeing, I'm looking for the return of the Lord, especially around people who don't believe it's ever going to happen. And the greatest enemy in our country against the gospel of grace is cynicism. They just don't believe nothing. They don't believe nobody can be genuine in their belief and in their walk with Jesus Christ. But there's a move of God and a move of the Spirit that's taking place. And I'm telling you, Jesus is about to stand up on the inside of all y'all. And those who didn't believe are going to all of a sudden believe. There are going to be people walking in and work talking about, can I talk to you during lunch? I want to find out how to get saved. God been dealing with me. I'm telling you, God's dealing with a lot of people. God's changing some people that you thought never would be able to change. But He changed you, didn't He? And if He can change you, He can change some other people. So Brothers and sisters, get ready to be used by the Lord Jesus Christ. Look for Him. Hallelujah. He is going to come back. He's coming back. It's not if, but when He comes back. Hallelujah. That great day will come. Glory, where the clouds will unfold and split open. And there Jesus right now stepping through the clouds. I'm expecting the return of the Lord. I'm looking for His return. Glory to God. I'm looking that when He shows up, I'm going to be changed. We will be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, and we'll be caught up to meet Him in the air, and there shall we ever be with the Lord. And the Bible says, encourage one another with these words. I'm looking for the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't talk me out of it. You can't convince me it's not going to happen. You're too late. I'm already looking for my home. I am not a citizen here in this world. I'm a citizen in heaven. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I'm a foreigner in this world. Glory to God. I'm an alien in this world. Hallelujah. But one day I'll return back. Let me go and leave that thing alone. The Bible says that's your great hope. That's your great hope. Now, let's get into this worldly lust. The Holy Spirit, through His grace, will begin to teach us to refuse worldly lust. Now, I guarantee you this is not going to come out like you think it is. Go to 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, 17 in the King James. 1 John 2, 15 through 17 in the King James. Grace teaches us. Grace teaches us. Isn't that amazing? He teaches us who believe. All right, now watch this. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passes away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Quickly, let's read that in the NLT. Let's look at it in the NLT. Do not love this world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure. It offers a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from this world. And this world is fading away. This world system is fading away, along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever. Now listen to me very carefully. If you have lost your joy, if you feel like you're far away from God, if you're busy but with no purpose, if you're bored with spiritual things, then maybe you're too attached to this world. Maybe you might have become worldly and not know it. Huh? Some of you may be thinking at that particular point, well, Brother Dollar, I don't cuss in public. I don't cheat. I don't steal. I don't own a Rolls Royce. In fact, I attend and I give and I serve and I love the preaching of the Word of God. I'm not worldly. But these are not the things that determine worldliness, as we have thought. You cussing and cheating and stealing, yeah, that would be worldly, but it's not the deeper issue. some of the things we call worldly. Ain't nothing wrong with that. The scripture says, love not the world. Now, here's what it means. Love not the fallen, wicked system that leaves God out and lies under the influence of Satan. Don't love this wicked system that leaves God out. Now, you know, the world system leaves God out. The world system leaves God out of everything. It's almost become a running joke. In the world system, it's you that's responsible for everything. We leave God out of that. And if you dare bring him up, then you'll enter into a conversation, well, you know, I don't really believe in God, or I'm not religious, or all these kind of things. That's what the world would say. The world system, the wicked system, it leaves God out, and it lies, this system lies under the influence of Satan. So the world system all lies under satanic influence. Look at 1 John 5:19. 1 John 5:19, a system of operation that disregards God, a wicked system that turns its back on God. 1 John 5:19 says, and we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. So this system is demonically influenced. Oh, no, you're trying to say that just because I disregard God, that it's wicked. Yeah, that's what it is. Worldliness refers to the harmful values that Satan spreads throughout humanity. Worldliness is basically the norms and values of the world. The norms and values of the world, here's how it operates. Somebody says, well, that's all right, because everybody else says it's all right. And that becomes the value of the world, because everybody says it's okay. It must be okay because everybody says it's okay. And so now it becomes a norm, and it's like, okay, well, since it's a norm and everybody's been doing it and everybody's done it, and that becomes right because everybody says it's right. Can't you see what's happened so far? Can't you see how confused the world's operation is becoming? More and more, they can't even come up with a solution for a simple problem. All of the problems are becoming so complex. Simple solutions, but don't have no idea how to get those solutions, because the whole world lies in wickedness. Well, Brother Dollar, I need to understand. I was told that entertainment is worldly. And so let's deal with that for a moment. Does entertainment, like movies and games, count as worldly? See, I have to say that because church folks take the cheaper and then use it to beat everybody up. Do you go to the movies? That's worldly. I'm still gonna go to the movies. So it's amazing to me, even though people try to condemn you with that, we don't even know what's worldly. What defines something as being worldly? You know, I was, looking at, listening to some older song, oldie goodie songs, and this song came on, it's cheaper to keep her. Yeah. And then Tap said, you know the words? I said, no, but Ken knows all the words to these songs. And Tap turned to me, she said, listen to the song, it's cheaper to keep me. But it's worldly. I remember before they had drums in the church, drums were worldly. When the fashion began to change amongst women, only thing that was, you couldn't wear pants, they were worldly. You couldn't show your, no parts of your shoulders, because you would cause the deacons of lust. Sounds like a personal problem to me. So I never could, because it felt like I was being put more and more in bondage.
Have you become confused about what is and what is not ungodly? Creflo Dollar gets to the bottom of how God's grace guides you into a life of true godliness in his series, Godliness versus Ungodliness.
Worldliness stems from a heart that desires anything but the Lord first.
You got to believe that grace is able to instruct you and to teach you how to live a godly life, to refuse worldly lust.
The likeness of Christ comes through inhabitation. He's in me. The secret is Jesus lives in me. The number one work of the Holy Spirit is to change you.
This five-message series can be yours for a love gift of just $30 US for CDs or $40 US for the DVD set. Call the number on your screen, scan the QR code, or visit CreflodollarMinistries.org and click eStore. Order yours today.
Welcome to A Place Built for You. Where finding grace messages to watch is easy. Where your spiritual needs are met. Where you can access CYWN anytime you want. Where exclusive content is accessible 24 hours a day. Where getting spiritually fed anytime you want feels fulfilling, uplifting, simple.
There's a great harvest that's been prophesied for centuries of time. The wealth of the wicked, how many of you know that transfer must take place? But you know what? We've got to make room for the new.
Welcome to the Creflo Dollar Ministries TV app. Visit your Roku, Amazon, or Apple TV app store and download the Creflo Dollar Ministries TV app now to start streaming for free. For more information, visit CreflodollarMinistries.org.
Creflo Dollar Global Missions has fed, clothed, housed, and shared the gospel of grace with people on practically every continent. I want to take a moment to encourage you to visit our website and catch up on all the missions work we're doing around the world. You may never visit these places or witness the poverty and levels of human suffering firsthand, but your support, prayers, and selfless giving equipped us to go and to change lives for the better. Thank you for caring enough to proactively take steps to stop misfortune in the lives of others. And thank you.
If you want to support our global missions outreach endeavors, consider becoming a partner today by calling in or by visiting us online and signing up. Thank you for partnering with us today.
Text to give with SecureGive is a fast, easy way to give from anywhere, anytime. It's just two quick steps. First, text the keyword CDMBC followed by the amount you like to give to 74483. Second, when asked to confirm, just text Y and your transaction is complete. That's all there is to it. Text to give, the fastest, easiest way to give on the go.
The preceding program was brought to you by the partners and friends of Creflo Dollar Ministries.